It's been about a year now of owning and running my CNC plasma table, and it's opened up new ideas on how I'm able to make things in sheet metal. However, I've always felt that there was something missing in the process, and that was sheet metal bending using a brake press. I believe a brake press paired with the CNC plasma or laser is one of the most underrated processes for making parts with sheet metal. Hi, my name is Ratha Sochenda, and in this video series, I'll share the process of building out my homemade brake press, which will include a NC control back gauge and limit switches to tell how far the punch die needs to travel down to achieve a desired and repeatable bend angle. As you guys probably know, I've developed a product which is a universal tire carrier into a DIY weldable kit. I made version 1 and then refined it in version 2. Version 2 has components with bends and in turn has less parts, making it easier to assemble. Some of the bends that were created had what are called bend reliefs, which is simply a small area of material removed at the edge where the bend will be. Before I had my brake press, I had to include these reliefs in order to make it possible for me to bend by hand. Soon after, the production of the kit picked up, and eventually bending parts by hand became a little bit frustrating. I spent some time researching different brake presses to buy, ranging from as little as $200 to $20,000. I really wasn't impressed with some of the hobbyist weekend warrior type brake presses that I'd seen, mainly because I wanted something that used real tooling steel for the dies. The next thing up from that was something over $20,000, which was a full-on CNC press brake. I, however, was looking to spend in the $2,000 to $4,000 range. I was just really surprised that there wasn't anything in the middle. I mean, the only ones were like outdated used presses going at auctions, but they didn't have the tonnage I needed, and they required some work. And then I stumbled upon a brake press attachment from a company called Cyclops Design. I was a little bit apprehensive at first because there was little to no information about it in the US. And I think mainly because it was developed and sold over in the UK. After reaching out to Tom, the owner, I discussed my needs and if it checked all my requirements. To make this brake press tool fully functional, it needed an H-frame style shop press. Since the working area is about 24 inches wide, it needed an H-frame opening of 30 inches for it to fit. Again, there was nothing that I can buy that impressed me, so like most of my projects, I designed my own. The goal for my brake press system was I wanted it to make repeatable bends. This meant I needed to make some type of backstop and vertical stop. I also wanted to power it using an electric pump that would drive the hydraulic 30-ton cylinder. And you guys already know I wanted high-quality tooling for the punch dies and V-block, and that's what the Cyclops Design press brake tool gave me. Fourth, I want to tie it all in with the control box, which has E-stops. And then last, I wanted the auto retract. With my goals in mind, it was time to lay it out in 3D using my favorite CAD program, SolidWorks. So let's break down the setup, starting from the bottom up. To make this mobile and to level it, I'll be using leveling casters with a ratchet handle design. For the H-frame, I'm using thick wall square tubing for the uprights and the base leg, and combining C-channel to make an I-beam for the bed frame and for the upper cross member. Overall, it'll be about 6 feet tall, 3 feet wide, and 3 feet total from front to back. The brake press attachment is from Cyclops Design. It uses a finger punch dies with four-way V-block, similar tooling to what you'd find in a commercial CNC press brake. To set my upper and lower limits of the brake press, I plan on using mechanical limit switches. For the backstop, I'm using a motorized linear actuator that will serve as an adjustable backstop. This way, I know how far back I need to position my sheet metal material. I'll be using a 30-ton hydraulic cylinder with a 4-inch stroke. To drive the cylinder, I'll be using an electric single-stage pump with helper springs to speed up the retract. I'll be adding a DRO, a digital readout, which will give me the readouts for the vertical depth and the backstop. Then to tie it all together, I'll have a control box that will have an e-stop to kill the entire system, a controller for the backstop, and a auto retract feature. I'll leave resources and links in the video description to the build plans of this brake press system that I've created and all the items I've used in this video. With that out of the way, let's build this. I start with the H-frame. I first cut the uprights and the base legs using thick wall square tubing. I do this over on my LS bandsaw, which makes it easy and accurate. To make the uprights easy to move around, I go ahead and tap the holes and install the casters. These casters have a combined capacity of 2,200 pounds, and I love the ratcheting feature that allows these to level the brake press. And they also roll great on my garage floors. These are similar to what I've used when I built my welding table. To make the bed frame and the upper cross member, I decided to use C-channel. Reason why was they were just easier to source. I-beam would have worked as well, but at my local yard, I had to either special order it or I'd get remnant size remnant drops of them. I used half inch flat bar and combined the two C-channels to make my desired I-beam. After getting my two uprights tacked in, I jigged them up on my homemade fixture table to get them positioned and squared. Man, I can't say enough good things about this fixturing table. It really has made fabrication more enjoyable and helps keep my parts in position. Here, I spent some time getting everything lined up correctly and squared before I tacked everything in place. To make sure the tooling would fit, I slid it off my table and did a quick test fit. Next, I moved on to making the mount for the hydraulic cylinder. This would help keep the cylinder in line with the frame and the press. Then install the tabs for the retract springs. I decided to go with 4 springs over 2 to pretty much help speed up the return of the hydraulic cylinder. When welding in the 4 tabs, I made sure to position them so that the springs would clear the cylinder and the cylinder handle. Now with everything tacked in, I did another quick test fit to see how everything should work. So far, so good. Now it was time to weld it all in. think now is a good time to quickly go over the Cyclops design brake press tool that I got. The construction of the frame is built primarily out of half-inch thick plate. The base looks to be machined flat and reinforced by some tubing beneath. The ram or punch rides on machine rods using linear bearings, so there is no slop. The tooling is made from the same material you see in commercial CNC brake presses, and I think it could withstand about 80 to 88 tons of force. The upper punch dies are segmented. It has a four-way V-block, which gives you flexibility on how tight of a bend race you can bend and will help determine what thickness you can bend. The working bend width is 610 millimeters or 23 5/8 inches. Now let's do some bending. Luckily I had to make a pump tray and a mount, so this was good to see this press brake in action. This is a 3/16 thick steel, and so far I'm excited and impressed by the result for bending. The inner bend radius is tight and the bend is uniform throughout the bend area. To get the 90 degree bend, I used the magnetic digital angle finder and bumped the pedal until I got close. To make this frame overkill, I added some diagonal supports. Then plate welded the connections. I jigged up the pump tray and welded that in, then installed the hydraulic pump. Next was to figure out how to make repeatable bends. For this, I used this cheap mechanical limit switch I found on Amazon and wanted to give it a try. How this will work is that the ram will travel down to a measured depth until it hits the switch that kills the power or disconnects the foot pedal, which then stops the ram. To make this vertical distance adjustable, I added in a threaded bolt that you can adjust. To make this all come together now, I made a bracket that attaches to the ram. This is the part that moves up and down when pressing parts. I then decided to install a linear guide rail to the bracket so that it would track straight. Honestly, this probably wasn't necessary as the bracket was stout enough, but I wanted a solid connection, I guess. Now was to install the threaded screw. I used a coupler and a nut to lock it in place. But before I can install the bolt, it's weird, these bolts come with this like bevel on the end of it, and I wanted that flat to keep the bends consistent. So I took it over to my grinder to grind it flat. I then installed a spacer to offset the bolt so that it falls in line with the roller of the limit switch. Now to create a starting point, I brought the ramp all the way down until it bottomed out on the V-block, and then I adjusted the bolt until I heard a click. This click is when the circuit is broken. Then after making a few adjustments from there on the bolt, I was able to set the depth and lock it in to make 90-degree bends. And here is the result. Perfectly 9-degree bends that were consistent every time. This tells me that the limit switch is making consistent stops every time this is triggered. And with all that, we have reached the end of part one of this brake press build. In part two, we'll be putting together these parts of the build: the upper limit switch, the backstop, and even maybe the control box. Also, I plan on making a separate video on how thick and wide materials can be bent using this press brake tool, so stay tuned for that. Now, if you want to build one like this, I'll leave links to the build plans and the tools I used in the video description. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to smash that thumbs up button and subscribe for DIY projects like this. That's it for me. See you in part two.